The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
An Open Secret is a new documentary exposing the epidemic of pedophilia in Hollywood at the hands of managers, agents, publicists, and producers. It's currently showing at Cinema Village in Manhattan and coming to Los Angeles July 17th. We're joined by Gabe Hoffman. He is the producer of the movie. So these children need to be protected. SAG-AFTRA, that's the union for all actors in Hollywood, they set up the SAG Young Actors Committee, which is specifically designed to protect young actors. Let's underline and circle this. Michael Hara used to be the head of the SAG Young Actors Committee, which is to protect young actors specifically from being molested by predators. In an interview in your movie, An Open Secret, he is exposed as someone who tried to bed one of the actors featured in your movie. The executive director of SAG-AFTRA, I believe his name is David White, immediately threatened to sue you for showing Michael Hara in a compromising position instead of asking to see the footage so that he could conduct an investigation of Michael Hara. Is that correct?
Yes.
And is there an investigation going on now of Michael Hara? I mean, Michael Hara knew enough to quit right after the interview, right?
And that is our point, is that this should not be a topic, child sex abuse in general, SAG or anywhere else, that anybody should be ashamed of discussing. That discussion is helpful, and that what would have been helpful is not for Michael Hara to have quietly resigned a couple of days later, but for SAG to have announced that they had done such an investigation, completed it, and made it known to the public that Michael Hara had been exposed and you know, kicked out of SAG, so that in case there were any clients of his out there or other victims who were more recent or ongoing, that could be broadcast as loudly as possible.
Now, David, Rob, and Deadline...
To get rid of this problem, we have to talk about it. We don't have to try to hide it.
Right. So David, Rob, and Deadline Hollywood reports that SAG-AFTRA executive director David White denied threatening to sue you. He denied to the SAG-AFTRA board that he ever threatened to sue you. Is that true? Did he threaten to sue you?
In the interest of transparency, David, Rob came to us about things. We wanted to make sure that the accurate part of the story went out there, and we felt the best that we could do by SAG is making sure the letters are out there. They are. People can see them and make their own judgments. The David White thing was a second story. It shows that David Robb clearly has his own sources within SAG as a longtime respected journalist looking out for child protection in Hollywood, and that said what it said, and that's completely separate from any dealings that we had with them.
Right, but he did threaten to sue you, right?
It was a more specific legal claim that said that, well, since Michael Hara's gone, you shouldn't mention that he ever was with us or mention the name. And our answer was he was a prominent member of SAG at the time of the interview. We identify him correctly at the time of the interview, and we do note afterwards that he resigned a few days later.
Okay.
So we felt we were accurate in every way, shape, and form, and as you can see, nothing has happened because of that.
Right. Michael Huffington, and I'm surprised you guys haven't been tied up in court by Michael Huffington because he comes from oil money. Very quickly, Arianna Huffington used to be married to Michael Huffington. She had two kids with the man. He served one term as a U.S. congressman, and then he ran for Senate in 1994. He narrowly lost to Dianne Feinstein. He's got oil money. Arianna Huffington ran him on a platform in 1994 that would deny health care and education to undocumented children. These are not good people. He ended up losing the Senate race, disappeared from politics, came out of the closet, identified himself as bisexual, disappeared, only to pop up in An Open Secret, your documentary. He pops up as a movie producer, an investor in a company called Den that produced movies, according to your documentary. It produced movies starring young boys that nobody was ever going to see. The entire purpose of this movie studio that Michael Huffington invested in. The entire purpose of this movie studio was so producers, the investors, could throw boy parties. Now, in the film, Michael Huffington is not only mentioned as an investor, he is identified on tape as attending one of these boy parties. What was the pushback from his lawyers? We don't see Michael Huffington's face at the boy party, but one of the hosts mentions him by name and points him out. The camera doesn't pan to him, but he is identified in your movie as an investor in Den and then showing up to these boy parties.
He did, in the case you're pointing out, he did invest $5 million in Den. That is correct. That is a fact cited by documents, so we have not heard from any complaints from that side. As to the specific scene which you're referencing, it appears to be during the late afternoon, and the hosts are indicating that Michael Huffington is at the house. There is not a party ongoing at that moment, but it seems clearly implied that there would be one going on later.
A party that involved shirtless boys going into hot tubs naked with adult men.
Copious drugs and alcohol around, clearly an unsafe situation. And we know that bad things, horrible things like abuse are certainly much more likely to happen when you have open drugs and alcohol and unsafe situations. And I guess if one were to draw a conclusion, it's this, that every single adult who did attend those Den parties, there were a lot of Den parties and there were a lot of adults. We don't know exactly who they were or when they were there, but every single one of them failed a basic moral responsibility to walk out and make a simple phone call to the police that there were young boys and drugs and alcohol being readily made available to everyone. If one person made that phone call, Den would have been over with much more quickly.
And Den was an internet movie company during the time of dial-up when you couldn't stream movies over the internet, and it featured young male actors, and these were movies that nobody ever saw because it was impossible to stream them over the internet.
Their idea to be Netflix 15 years ago before the technology was there was actually not a bad business concept, but the technology was not there to deliver it. They were, so therefore, as a business concept, it was going to fail, like so many other dot-com things in the dot-com era.
David Geffen was an investor in Den.
Correct. He invested $500,000.
And have his lawyers pushed back on this?
We have not heard from any.
Okay.
It's a fact. It's cited in public Securities and Exchange Commission filings.
Okay, that's pretty amazing. It's a great movie, An Open Secret. I recommend everybody go see An Open Secret. It opens in Los Angeles July 17th. I have a feeling it's going to be a secret. I can't imagine HBO or Netflix supporting you on this. I hope they do.
We are much more optimistic only because there has been an absolute groundswell of grassroots support for this film. We believe that the aftermarket, if you will, of DVDs and video on demand is simply just a function of do enough folks attend in theaters, and after that it's a financial calculation.
Right. It's An Open Secret. That's the name of the movie, An Open Secret. What is your website?
www.anopensecretfilm.com. Also on Twitter at An Open Secret, and we also have a Facebook page which is approaching 10,000 likes.
Let's end on an upbeat note. What is the difference between those who survive these attacks and those who don't? There's a young man named Evan Henze, who I believe was molested by Marty Weiss, and he wore a wire and exposed him for that. We learned from Evan Henze that one of the surest ways to survive and get past this is forgiveness. Where did he learn that? How does a young man like Evan Henze learn to forgive at such an early age?
I think that's clearly evidence of the point which we discussed earlier, that for a young man to find that type of strength is evidence of strong faith and strong family. that child sex abuse doesn't simply happen in some ugly, stereotypical trailer park, but even it can happen to the best families in the best neighborhoods in America.
Yes. Gabe Hoffman is the producer of An Open Secret.
If any profits are achieved from this film, they all go to the Courage to Act Foundation, and that has been prominently pledged in the film itself.
And what is the
We would never seek to make a dime off of exposing this horrible, horrible evil.
What is the Courage to Act Foundation, and what do you say to anybody out there who witnesses this kind of abuse or is a victim of this abuse?
Be courageous, report it, life gets better. Even Evan, who clearly was served just a total miscarriage of justice, didn't get the punishment he was looking for his predator. He still is glad that he came forward, that he reported it, and his life still is better, even though he didn't get the result he wanted.
Gabe Hoffman is the producer of An Open Secret. Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
David Robb has covered the labor beat, 10 years for Variety, 10 years for The Hollywood Reporter. He now works over at Deadline Hollywood, where he's written extensively about child labor in Hollywood. Thank you for joining us, David.
Thank you.
How many times have you seen An Open Secret?
I think I've seen it about 5 or 6 times.
Who is David White?
David White is the National Executive Director of the SAG-AFTRA, the Actors Union.
Did he try to block An Open Secret from ever being seen by anybody?
Well, he threatened to sue their lawyers with his knowledge, threatened to sue the producers unless they took out all references to SAG, SAG-AFTRA, and the SAG-AFTRA Young Performers Committee, unless they took that out of their picture.
There's an interview with Michael Hara in An Open Secret. He was a founder and chairman of the SAG-AFTRA Young Performers Committee. What was the responsibility of the Young Actors Committee?
Ostensibly was to look after the interests of young performers and look at issues affecting child actors in the entertainment industry.
What was their primary concern? Would it be predators, sexual predators?
No, their primary concern was wages and working conditions. The union only real jurisdiction over child actors is when they're on the set. They don't cover child actors when they're at auditions and when they're with their managers and on publicity junkets. It's only on the set, and that's where SAG-AFTRA has its jurisdiction over child actors, on the set. They don't really know if a child actor is being abused outside of the workplace.
Unless it's on the set.
Correct. That hardly ever happens. The abuse all takes place off the set.
Michael Hara in the movie, An Open Secret, admits to being molested as a child, and then we are introduced to Joey, a child actor who, according to An Open Secret, was victimized by Michael Hara.
Yes, Joey did a telephone conversation with Michael Hara, unbeknownst to Michael Hara, who was recording it, in which Michael Hara acknowledged that he had made unwanted advances towards Joey when he was a child actor.
And that's in the movie. And again, Michael Hara was the founder and chairman of the Young Actors Committee set up by SAG-AFTRA to protect children. What was David White, the executive director of SAG-AFTRA, what was David White's reaction to this interview?
Well, the interview was conducted at the offices of SAG-AFTRA. Within days after the interview, when all this stuff came out that Amy Berg, the director, had pulled out of Michael Hara during the interview, Michael Hara resigned from the Young Performers Committee, which he'd been on for like something like over 30 years. And then when they screened the film in New York last year as part of the New York Documentary Film Festival, they had identified Michael Hara as a member of the Young Performers Committee, and their lawyers sent them letters saying, he's not a member of the Young Performers Committee anymore. He's no longer on the committee. And they wanted them to remove all references to SAG, SAG-AFTRA, and to the Young Performers Committee, as if they didn't even exist. They didn't want SAG and the union to even be mentioned in the film, and they threatened to sue them if they didn't remove the union from the picture.
They threatened to sue. And what did David White tell the members of SAG-AFTRA about threatening to sue the producers of An Open Secret?
He told them that they didn't threaten to sue and that they didn't try to sanitize the picture. They just wanted it to accurately reflect that he was no longer a member of the Young Performers Committee, which he was at the time of the interview. But he was not any longer at the time the film was released.
Have you spoken to David White, the executive director of SAG-AFTRA?
No, he doesn't really give me interviews.
So you've tried to contact him on this story?
I contacted their spokesperson, Pam Greenwald. I shared with them everything that I was going to be writing about what they tried to do to sanitize the picture and threaten the lawsuit. And then they took the information that I gave them and they gave it to the Hollywood Reporter.
Oh, so they denied you your scoop?
They tried to, yeah. It was really laughable. It was really duplicitous. 4 o'clock on that Thursday, they'd asked for more time to respond. I gave them till 7:30, and they finally gave me a statement. And then at 8:30, all the information that I'd told them about, not all, but a lot of it, appeared an hour later on the Hollywood Reporter's website.
Have they disciplined Michael Hara? Have they conducted an investigation into Michael Hara?
SAG does not investigate. They're not an investigative agency. They thought that this should have been taken to the police. The police, as far as I know, nobody's investigating Michael Hara. And all these things happened long ago, way past the statute of limitations. There's really nothing that can be or is going to be done.
How complicit is SAG-AFTRA in all this?
Well, SAG-AFTRA is not complicit in that they are aiding and abetting child molesters. They're just ineffective, is the word I would use. There's really not much they can do to stop it.
Earlier this week on my show, I referred to an epidemic of pedophilia in Hollywood. You see the movie An Open Secret, it certainly suggests that. Corey Feldman says, as a child actor, there was a miasma of predators hanging above him. Is there an epidemic of pedophilia in Hollywood?
Well, it depends on what an epidemic is. There's a lot of it. I wouldn't say that.
Is it more pronounced here than it would be, say, in, I was going to say, Washington, D.C., but is it more pronounced than any other place in the country, or is it just about average? Oh,
there's a famous bank robber who says, "Why do you rob banks?" He says, "That's where the money is." And in Hollywood, that's where the most beautiful children are. Hollywood is a definite draw. It's not just Hollywood now. The entertainment industry is spread all across the country. But child predators seek out children, and Hollywood's got a lot of them.
Before the show started, we talked about the dangers of hysteria. Because you brought up the McMartin preschool. The accusations last longer than the acquittal. When you say McMartin preschool, people, all they remember is, oh, that was the place where children were molested and they were practicing Satan worshiping. But what's the truth about the McMartin preschool?
It was all false. It was all made up. There was a hysteria going around the entire country. There was a whole wave of allegations that children were being sexually molested at the preschools all over the country. The McMartin case turned out to be totally false. It was a bunch of elderly ladies were being accused of sexually abusing children. That has never been the pattern. And it turned out to be completely false. All the people were exonerated, except their lives were ruined.
Their lives were ruined by psychologists who knew how to get the responses they wanted from these kids.
Yes, by using anatomically correct little puppets and things. And the children would just make up all these things.
You've seen An Open Secret 6 times. What do you think of the movie?
I think the movie is a wake-up call to the industry that people need to pay more attention to this real issue, that children are being abused, that there are predators out there. There's a long list of them who have been convicted. And to me, it points to a total failure by the state to monitor what's happening with child actors. I've written several stories. There have been at least 3 imposters posing as studio teachers so that they can be around children. I'm not saying that they were molesting them. It might have just been to collect the money, the paycheck, but they're not qualified, they're not certified, and children are not being protected by the state. The state labor commissioner is in charge of certifying all studio teachers and for the safety and welfare of child actors, and they're not doing their job at all.
You have a long career in journalism. Why are documentarians, independent documentarians, doing this work instead of our mainstream media?
That's a good question. I think the media does its best when allegations are brought forth and criminal charges are filed. The media is all over it. But the media hasn't really been able to get behind the scenes and find out what's going on, because oftentimes the parents of the children don't even know what's happening until years later, and the children don't come forth with the allegations until years later. And then it's very hard to prove. It becomes a he said, he said.
Mm-hmm. Is Amy Berg, the director, practicing good journalism? Is an open secret good journalism?
I think it is very good journalism. It doesn't pretend to be a newspaper, but as a documentary film, I think it's brilliant work. And I think it's just the tip of the iceberg. They focused on things that they could prove, and that they had people who would be willing to speak. It's just almost a bottomless pit.
Yeah.
This is the David Feldman Radio Network.
Anne Henry is the founder of Showbiz Parents, founded in 2003 to protect children from financial and sexual predators. Her work is the basis for much of the research done for An Open Secret. Thank you for joining us again, Anne.
Thank you, David.
The greatest joy I've had as a parent is the gift of constantly saying no to my child. I love saying no to my children, because most of what they want is wrong. So if my children came to me and said, I want to be famous, I want to be an actor or actress, I personally delight in saying no. Okay.
Well, here's what I would give you as an alternative. I would say, tell them that they have to do the work first. They have to go to acting class for a year. They have to do some community theater where there isn't very much glory. They have to work behind the scenes. They have to decide whether they love it. And then you would support them after they show that they're interested in the real deal and not the fame.
But it's child labor, which, you know, it's the only form of child labor that's considered acceptable.
That's true.
There's a reason children are not allowed to work. Originally, it was because they needed to be in school. Also because they were being used to crawl into machinery because they were small enough to get in there, and they were getting killed and injured. You know, there's a reason kids don't work for a living. We protect.
Oh, there is. There is. And the only reason that entertainment has an exception for that is because they have passed a bunch of laws, and they have, I mean, it's really highly regulated down to the 20-minute mark on set of what you can do and can't do. So as long as people don't color outside the lines there and try and do something different, you know, there are some protections for them. It's certainly not foolproof, but you're right. A parent should look at this and say, wow, this is going to be a risky pursuit. How do I protect? In a defense mode, they should be saying, how do I protect my kid from this? Instead of an offensive mode of saying, throw my kid out there and go for it.
Yeah. During Elizabethan times, they used young boys to play the parts of women. I think we could save a lot of lives if we used women to play the parts of young boys instead of, let's get to the young boys.
Yes.
Okay. In An Open Secret, Corey Feldman said that as a child actor, he was surrounded by predators. Did you begin to see your children in the crosshairs of monsters?
We didn't see it. I have to be honest, we didn't see it at first. They're very good at what they do, and they are predators. So they're not just out there saying, hey, you know, they're not propositioning kids on set. It's not that obvious. They're the people who, in a professional sense, say to a parent and to a kid, I believe in your kid's talent, and I'm interested in doing that.
You have three kids, all boys?
No, I have two boys and a girl. The two boys are older.
Where did you see it more pronounced, with the boys?
Absolutely the boys, hands down. Like, almost exclusively boys. My daughter had a more high-profile career, and she did not have nearly the headaches that the boys had.
So they did have headaches, so there were older men creating awkward situations.
There were older men that would enter my orbit and quickly find out that I was going to be too much trouble for them to go any closer to my children.
How important is it for the boys to have a father who's present to keep the predators away?
It's a factor. I think if you didn't have any, we were lucky. I do, you know, I have been married to my husband for 30 years, and he was present. I think that it can be done, but again, it's a risk. You have to realize, wait a minute, if I'm a single mom here, I need to not have that mindset that says I'm going to seek out a male influence for my kids, because that puts you in danger.
Right, and the predators know this.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
A single parent family would be one. Very religious people, honestly, are a target, because they tend to believe the best in people, and they tend to not be as discerning as they probably should about strangers.
And they're forgiving. Your children posed for pictures, 8x10s. If you're going to be an actor, you need 8x10s.
Who is? Yeah, normal headshot pictures. Yeah, nothing salacious at all.
Who is Bob Villard? And you say that your children's pictures ended up being sold on eBay for how much?
Some of them, and I honestly don't remember which of our kids, but what caught our attention was the ones that were in the $150 to $300 zone. And they're nothing scary at all. They're very normal, bland.
You
consider them sexual at all.
Well, in the movie, there are a lot of pictures of young boys without their shirts on, looking up at the camera.
Yes, and every one of those pictures that you saw in the movie are kind of the next step after the first, you know, normal headshots. Then they might be, you know, when they start to befriend a photographer that turns out to be a bad guy, you know, they're taking those kind of pictures. Bob Villard took those kinds of pictures. But he did it. Most of those victims that you would see in the movie actually weren't in Hollywood yet. They were in middle America, or they were here for pilot season seeking a career, but they never got one, because the most abuses occur on the fringes.
Bob Villard is a photographer. He's a manager and a publicist. He is out of jail, but he is a registered sex offender, and he was convicted?
He was. He actually has quite the colorful history. He was a manager for some famous people like Tobey Maguire and Leonardo DiCaprio. He had a big client list as a publicist in the 80s. He was arrested in 2005, which was when my organization intersected paths with him.
Right.
And he was arrested for molesting a boy child actor and ended up doing a sentence of, I think, 7 years,
and
6 years.
Do we know what he's doing now?
He is out of prison and is a registered sex offender, yes, but he is living in the LA area. We don't know what he does to make a living today, other than that he continues to sell pictures on eBay.
In An Open Secret, we meet Joey. He was a child actor who appeared on Baywatch. Joey was, according to the movie, one of Bob Villard's victims?
Yes, that is our first introduction to Joey, is that he was a Villard victim. And then as it was discussed with him on camera, what had happened to him, it comes around that a manager named Michael Hara had introduced him to Bob Villard. Now it comes out that he was also a victim of Michael Hara. So again, the pedophiles knew each other. They were feeding each other victims. They were feeding each other information.
Michael Hara is a manager of children. He also served on the SAG-AFTRA Young Actors Committee. He founded the Young Actors Committee, set up to protect young actors from people like himself.
Yes.
In An Open Secret, the documentary, Michael Hara is interviewed, and we learn that he himself was a victim of sexual abuse as a child.
Yes, he was. I was familiar with Michael Hara. I knew him. I've talked to him many times. I did not know that until I saw the film. And it, as much as I am angry at the subject matter and certainly angry for the victims, I have to stop and consider that maybe there was something to that, that maybe he was a damaged soul from his own childhood. I mean, he's an elderly man, you could say. I think he's in his 70s now. So you got to wonder what happened to him 60 years ago in Hollywood, before there were protections, before there were any laws or any rules about, you know, welfare workers and set teachers on set and all that kind of stuff.
Did you feel sorry for him while watching?
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't that the problem? That is the problem, because we always say a child predator is a monster. Are they monsters? There are two types of monsters, and I think Frankenstein encapsulates both.
Yes, that's a good analogy.
Because Frankenstein is scary, And at the same time, we have sympathy for Frankenstein, don't we?
Yeah.
This is the David Feldman.